Welcome to News Talk ZB. Jack Tame in the hot seat through to midday. Kicking us off this hour, Stephen Drongle, our relationship expert, with advice on how to seduce your lover for the next 50 years. Now, when you told us you wanted to talk about this today, Stephen, we got a little bit anxious, got a little bit nervy, but we're going to keep things as PG as possible, because actually it's really important, is it? Your relationship changes dramatically as you go through different stages of life, and that like intimacy changes as well.
Yeah.
So where do we start?
All right, so first off, the people I want to apologize to in advance are the teenagers. Please block your ears now. And because all of this is based on the idea that you didn't arrive on this planet, apart from the fact that at some point in time, you know, your mum and dad, you know, got close and friendly with each other. So
they
I apologize in advance. This is a fact of life, but you can block your ears now. So, so one of the things that we tend to have... there's this issue when we think about seduction, and we have this idea that it's, you know, the guy picking, you know, someone up at a bar. And actually, in my view, that's not really seduction. That's really about selection. Because if you go out to a nightclub and you pick someone up at that, that doesn't really happen unless someone went along there with the openness or the,
intention.
The idea that is something that they were into.
Yeah.
And so, in my view, that's more about selection than seduction. It's finding the right person at that
yeah.
opportunity. But for me, seduction is really about changing someone's mindset, to shift them from one state of mind into another state of mind. And in seduction, we're in this case, we're sort of talking about someone, moving someone to be more open, more wanting connection, and in a sense, creating an environment of excitement, anticipation, joy, openness, all of those kind of things.
Yeah.
And as you're saying, when we get into relationships change over time. But one of the biggest challenges we tend to have is that in the honeymoon period, for generally the first about 6 to 18 months for most people, we get a bit of a free ride because our brain produces this hormone called phenylethylamine, or PEA for short. And phenylethylamine essentially makes your brain become really focused on the particular person that you're in love with, and it helps the imprinting process. But it also amplifies the awareness process in the prefrontal cortex. So if someone touches you, you know, that feels nice. If you're on PEA, so you're in that honeymoon period, it feels amazing, and you will fly to another country to spend a weekend with someone because you just want to be touched and be close to them, and it feels really great. So in a sense, in that first honeymoon period, people tend to get a bit of a free ride. And so then what happens after that is, once you get into a relationship that's more stable, that's more settled, then PEA wears off, because obviously, you know, you don't want to be spending the next 40 years of your life and, oh my God, I can't sleep, you know, I can only think about, you know, you, and you can't concentrate on work. It's not something that works in a great way for
Aww.
Us. Yeah. I mean, it sounds nice. It's just not particularly conducive towards, you know, making life happen.
Sure.
And so there's this, the thing that basically needs to happen where, you know, one of the things that guys will often say is like, oh, you know, I don't see why I have to do this much work, you know, because it used to be really, really easy. And the thing that I'm saying to them is, actually, it wasn't really easy at the start. You were working really hard. You know, you got dressed up, you know, you shaved, you did all of those things. You may have spent a great deal of money, and, you know, there was a lot of planning. I'm going to do this, I'm going to try that. So there was actually quite a lot of focus and intensity, which is one of the key elements of seduction, in the way that you were approaching the situation.
Yeah.
And then from women, they're like, well, I don't see, well, you know, he's the one that wants it all the time, you know. That this is the stereotype, sometimes you have the reverse, but you know, I don't see what it's up to, what I have to do with this. And again, it's saying, well, actually, you were the one that started this whole process, because you sent about 150 non-verbal signals to him that you were interested in him in particular, and around about 138 he picked up, thought it was his idea, wandered over, and you know, the process started. So so then there's that sense of kind of openness, like, so that there's that possibility of being open to, you know, to a new experience. And so the big challenge we have is, once we get into that, you know, after that first couple of years of the relationship, we need to be a little bit intentional, because our brain is essentially a routine making machine. So everything that we do, our brain learns from it and then figures out, how can I do this more efficiently, more effectively, and use less energy, so I don't have to worry about it so much.
Right.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And that's not great for seduction. Seduction involves awareness, present focus and being alive to the possibilities that are happening in the particular moment.
Right.
And so what we need to do is to shift our brain out of that routine and create a state of higher anticipation, higher excitement, a little bit of nervousness, a little bit of anticipation. And so it does require work. So that's the fundamental thing that we need to do.
How do we go about making that shift?
So basically what we want to do is, so for the guys, basically what I tell them is no woman wants to be easy. You know, so it's kind of insulting in a way if you're like, oh, well, you know, she should just give it me whenever I want. And actually, if she did, you would actually start valuing her less. So
right.
In terms of our psychology, guys tend to appreciate what we work for.
Yeah.
So the first thing that we start is actually starting to look at our partner in a particular way, you know, because when we're in our routine state, we tend to view our partner a little bit like an appendage. You know, they're the bit of us that, you know, does whatever they do. They go to work, they do the dishes, they cook, you know, whatever it is we expect from them. But we take a moment and we start to see them in a different way. So I remember recently having an experience of watching my partner deliver a presentation, and so she was a guest speaker, and I was taking some film with her. And I was sitting there and I was looking at her, and she's all dressed up, and I was saying, God, you're so hot, and you know. And I was feeling really kind of proud of her, and I was noticing how she was so eloquent, but I was seeing her in a different way. I was seeing her in a sense through the eyes of other people who were there.
Right.
And so one of the things that you can really do, and it's a very simple exercise, is taking a moment, you know, in each day where you just take a deep breath and just look at your partner for a moment, just 5-10 seconds, and take a moment and see what stands out for you. Because if you met someone that you fell in love with, that you imprinted on, there are parts of, you know, their body, the way that they talk, you know, the way that they see, that will still evoke stuff for you.
Yeah.
Now, if you've had lots of conflict and things are feeling really difficult, that might feel really hard. And if you can't find that, that's a really good invitation to go and get some help. Go and see a relationship therapist, go and talk about that, so you can kind of clear some of the garbage out of the way so you can see them in that way. It's a little bit like kind of cleaning your spectacles so that you can see through the fog. So you're looking at them in that way and taking a moment to see what you're drawn to, because it will change from moment to moment. But what it does is it switches your brain into a state where you're activating gamma frequency in the brain, so the highest level frequency in the brain, and it's actually a kind of a meditation or an awareness state.
Right.
So instead of focusing on the breath, your partner becomes your breath. So you allow yourself to have that experience, that experiential encounter with this amazing human being who for some weird reason has decided they're going to choose you to be in their life. Mm. And take a moment and enjoy it in your body. Yeah? And what will probably happen is your partner is going to notice that, and they'll be like, looking at you like,
what are you doing?
And so really just taking a moment and being vulnerable. So that's, you know, one of the second things about, thank God, you know, I love your ... remembering the PG audience. And taking a moment. And so
telling them is the point, though. Actually explaining, you know, well, this is what I'm seeing in you.
Well, actually, for some people, like, some people are quite verbal.
Yeah.
And so, you know, telling them works really good. And I encourage that. But sometimes it can be, after you've told them a few times, it might just be that look where you look at your partner and you're just kind of checking them up and down, and they're like, I know exactly.
They
give you the look back, and so you've had a moment.
Yeah.
And so what we're doing here, so the second element of seduction, apart from that focus and intensity, is kind of misdirection.
Right.
Yeah? Because seduction is not about, it's not a bulldozer, oh, I'm looking at you, so now you need to do blah, blah, blah.
Mm.
It's like, I'm looking at you, and we're in the middle of the supermarket, and nothing's going to happen, probably, maybe, you know. And so it creates a sense of excitement, anticipation, you know, adrenaline kind of happening. And then it's like a misdirection. So what's for dinner?
Yeah, right.
And then it's like, you know. And so then they become on high alert.
Yeah, right.
And so the moment, you know, couples often come in, you know, where they're sort of having conflict, and a pretty common conflict is you've got one person who wants to, you know, make love a lot more than the other person. They're like, you know, what's the right amount that we should be doing this? And so I basically say, look, I think on average couples should be making love about 10 times a day. And you're like, both of them.
Like, what?
And what I'm saying is, you know, what we want to do is expand the definition of that.
Right.
You know, so.
Right. I like that. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And so you're just having lots of those opportunities so that, you know, when you wake up in the morning, you're looking at each other, you're cuddling, you're stroking, you know, you're doing that kind of thing, you know, you're wolf whistling when they walk through the lounge. I mean, mm-hmm. your goal should basically be, sorry, teenagers again, to embarrass the crap out of your teenagers.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. you know, and they're going to squirm at some level.
Yeah.
But what you're doing is you're modeling them how to be in a happy relationship. Yeah. Because, you know, you can tell when couples come in, I don't see that many of them, but sometimes couples come in and they've got generally another issue that's outside the relationship. Sometimes they have communication issues, but they, you know, that the seduction chemistry, all of that stuff is working really great in this relationship. And you can tell, like, they look good, they feel good, that you know, it's just such a resource in the relationship. And so my view is recognizing that when you're in a relationship, your quality of life is directly related to this part of it. And so it's great to have safety, it's great to have connections, great to have all of those kind of things, but we also need to play.
Yeah.
And ultimately that's the bit that holds it together. Take a moment to enjoy your partner, play with them, and life will get better.
Thank you so much for your advice. As always, Stephen, we really appreciate it. Stephen Drongal, our relationship expert.